On July 20, 1969, an estimated 650 million people worldwide watched as Neil Armstrong became the first person to walk on the moon.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Armstrong became a global icon overnight, but few knew the man behind the spacesuit carried a deep pain, the death of his young daughter, a grief that fueled his drive. Long before Apollo, Armstrong nearly died numerous times in the skies. This is the story of how a man shaped by tragedy, who cheated death more than once, was destined to become the first to set foot on another world. Ever since he was a little boy growing up in Ohio, Neil loved planes and wanted to be an aircraft designer. It was a Navy scholarship that opened the door. Under the Holloway Plan, the Navy funded his aeronautical engineering degree at Purdue University in exchange for 3 years of military service. As part of his duties, he learned to land fighter jets on aircraft carriers, the most demanding test of a pilot's skill. He actually didn't stand out as a pilot at first. One of his instructors noted, "Should be able to continue on in program and make an average pilot. Not someone you predict would one day walk on the moon." But he quietly excelled, and his calm demeanor may have saved his life during the Korean War. On September 3, 1951, while flying just 500 feet above ground, dropping bombs on freight yards and a bridge over North Korea, his jet sliced through a cable, likely a trap, which sheared off 6 feet of his right wing. He knew he couldn't eject over enemy territory, so he stayed calm and guided the damaged aircraft south, aiming for a U.S. airfield in Pohang, South Korea, and failing that, ejecting over the sea. But he misjudged the wind and landed in a nearby rice paddy with nothing but a cracked tailbone. His cool handling of the situation at just 21 years old was one of the first clear signs of the steady temperament that would eventually take him to the moon. After the war and upon graduating from Purdue in 1955, he set out to become a test pilot and joined the NACA, the predecessor to NASA, where he flew cutting-edge aircraft, often prototypes, to help build the most advanced planes in the world. Although the top test site at Edwards Air Force Base in California had no openings, he accepted a position at the Lewis Flight Propulsion Laboratory in Cleveland, Ohio, his home state, and conveniently close to Janet Sheeran, his college sweetheart whom he planned to marry. Just 5 months later, he got his wish to transfer to Edwards and headed toward the sunny skies of California. He logged over 900 flights at Edwards Air Force Base, eventually piloting the X-15, one of the most advanced and dangerous rocket-powered planes ever built. On one flight in April 1962, he flew so high and fast that he overshot the base by 40 miles, gliding down to an emergency landing on a dry lake bed, one of several close calls in his career as a test pilot. Years later, he acknowledged that the death of his little girl may have shaken him more than he realized. On January 28, 1962, his two-year-old daughter Karen, whom he affectionately called Muffy, passed away from a brain tumor on the 6th anniversary of his and Janet's wedding. He loved his daughter deeply, but always kept his emotions in check. As James Hansen, author of First Man, The Life of Neil A. Armstrong, writes, "People who knew Armstrong well indicated that Neil never once over the years brought up the subject of his daughter's illness and death. In fact, several of his closest working associates stated that they did not know that Neil ever had a daughter. He went straight back to work, which hurt his wife, who needed his emotional support, but he carried the weight of his pain with him. His sister June believed it was Karen's death that redirected the course of his life. She told author Hansen, "The death of his little girl caused him to invest those energies into something very positive, and that's when he started into the space program. And the timing couldn't have been more pivotal. The Soviets had launched Sputnik 5 years earlier, shocking Americans and triggering a space race that led to the creation of NASA. In May 1961, President Kennedy issued a bold challenge.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth."
Armstrong could have continued flying the X-15 and eventually become chief test pilot, but the astronaut program felt bigger. He told author James Hansen, "Apollo was just so overpoweringly exciting that I decided to give up these other opportunities to pursue it, even though I knew it may never happen." A former colleague he had worked closely with at the NACA, flight simulation expert Dick Day, sat on the astronaut selection committee and vouched for him. Armstrong's years at Edwards working with flight simulators gave him a significant advantage, developing the skills he'd used to land on the moon, a level of technical insight that none of the other 8 chosen astronauts in his group had. He quickly earned the respect of those around him. Fellow astronaut Frank Borman later said, "Because he was so quiet and so thoughtful, when he said something, it was worth listening to." Buzz Aldrin put it this way, I don't remember seeing him lose his cool.
His calmness under pressure was put to the ultimate test during the Gemini 8 mission that came before Apollo.
While traveling at 17,000 miles an hour, or 27,000 kilometers an hour, around 10 times faster than a speeding bullet, they docked with the Agena target vehicle. Then, without warning, the spacecraft began spinning out of control. At first, they suspected the Agena was the culprit, so Armstrong decided to undock. But the spinning became worse, confirming that Gemini, not Agena, was the problem. A short-circuited thruster on Gemini had stuck open, sending the capsule tumbling at a terrifying rate of over one full rotation per second. Armstrong feared they'd lose consciousness, so he fired the re-entry control thrusters, which were only meant to be used at the end of the mission, during the final descent back to Earth. It was risky, but it worked, and the spinning stopped. Once Gemini was stabilized, they made an emergency landing in the Pacific Ocean. Armstrong's quick thinking saved their lives, but three of his colleagues, Gus Grissom, Ed White, and Roger Chaffee, would be less fortunate. On January 27, 1967, during a routine pre-launch test for Apollo 1, a fire broke out inside the command module while it was on the launch pad. The astronauts desperately tried to open the hatch, but had no chance of escaping. The heat and pressure inside the sealed, 100% oxygen cabin became so intense that the command module ruptured. Within seconds, the spacecraft was engulfed in flames. The cause of the explosion was a frayed electrical wire that sparked and ignited nearby flammable materials. When news of the tragedy broke, Armstrong and several other astronauts were in D.C. witnessing the signing of the Outer Space Treaty. They were stunned and devastated. That night, they opened a bottle of scotch and sat together trying to make sense of what had gone wrong. The Apollo program came to a halt as engineers made over 1,300 design changes, including overhauling the command module's atmosphere system so that it was no longer 100% oxygen at launch, but rather a safer 60% oxygen and 40% nitrogen mix, with nitrogen bleeding off as the spacecraft ascended. After 2 years of hard lessons, it was full speed ahead. Armstrong had proven himself during Gemini 8, and again in 1968, when he ejected at the last second from a lunar landing simulator that lost control, saving his life. So when the time came to assign a commander for Apollo 11, the first mission to land on the moon, he was the clear choice. When Armstrong's mother, Viola, heard he had been made commander, she described how, "A flood of tears gushed from my eyes. There was tumult within me. I sobbed in anguish. Soon, I was on my knees in prayer." Mike Collins was selected as the command module pilot. He wouldn't walk on the moon, but would remain in lunar orbit aboard Columbia, ensuring Armstrong and Aldrin had a ride home. Armstrong chose Buzz Aldrin as his lunar module pilot, who would accompany him to the moon. Aldrin was intelligent and extremely driven, though not always the easiest to work with. He lobbied hard to be the first to step on the moon, which became a real point of tension. Astronaut Gene Cernan recalled, "He came flapping into my office at the Manned Spacecraft Center one day like an angry stork, laden with charts and graphs and statistics, arguing what he considered to be obvious, that he, the lunar module pilot, and not Neil Armstrong, should be the first down the ladder on Apollo 11.
Armstrong, on the other hand, didn't lobby. He focused on the mission.
Chris Kraft, NASA's Director of Flight Operations, told author Hansen, "He had no ego. If you would have said to him, 'You are going to be the most famous human being on Earth for the rest of your life,' he would have answered, 'Then I don't want to be the first man on the moon.'" But that's exactly why NASA chose him to step on the moon first. They saw in him a quiet humility, the kind of man who wouldn't let ego overshadow a moment meant for all humankind. Starting in January 1969, the crew trained 14 hours a day, 6 days a week. While Aldrin preferred to win simulations and avoid crashes, Armstrong tested worst-case scenarios because he understood the real test wouldn't be in success, but in how they recovered from failure.
After a decade of planning and hard work, we're willing and ready to attempt to achieve our national goal. And we're very happy to be ready to fly.
On July 16, 1969, Apollo 11 lifted off from Launch Complex 39 at Kennedy Space Center, sitting atop the towering Saturn V rocket. Armstrong's heart rate at launch peaked at 110 beats per minute, compared to Collins' 99 and Aldrin's 88. It wasn't fear, it was focus, as his body was preparing for what lay ahead. 12 minutes after launch, they reached Earth's orbit. Collins maneuvered the command module Columbia, turning and docking it with the lunar module Eagle. On July 20, 4 days after launch, Armstrong and Aldrin crawled into Eagle, leaving Collins behind in lunar orbit. During undocking, a small amount of residual pressure in the docking tunnel gave the lunar module a slight but unintended push, causing Eagle to overshoot its original landing site. The new trajectory brought them dangerously close to a boulder-strewn crater.
Armstrong had to act fast.
He took manual control at around 500 feet, steering the lunar module away from the crater and in search of a flat landing area, his visibility hampered by dust. At approximately 100 feet, a warning light came on indicating that only 5% fuel remained. Mission control began the countdown.
30 seconds forward.
They believed they only had 30 seconds of fuel left to land before they'd have to call in abort. But Armstrong, guided by instinct and years of experience, held steady. And then, at 4:17 p.m. Eastern time,
Houston, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Armstrong named the landing site Tranquility Base, then spoke the words that would echo through history.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
He later clarified that he meant to say one small step for a man. Whether he misspoke or the radio transmission failed to pick it up remains unclear. Armstrong and Aldrin planted the American flag together.
They've got the flag up now, and you can see the stars and stripes.
Nearly all of the iconic photos taken on the moon are of Buzz Aldrin, photographed by Neil Armstrong. Aldrin, on the other hand, took almost no photos of Armstrong. There's only one image of Armstrong on the moon with his full body visible, and even then, his back is to the camera. The only other image of him is a reflection in the visor of Aldrin's helmet. Aldrin later admitted, "I felt so bad about that, but I was intimidated by the enormity of the situation. I should have taken it upon myself to do that." He explained that it never occurred to him to take pictures of Armstrong as they hadn't rehearsed it during training. Yet, he did take pictures of his own boot print on the moon, which weren't part of the simulation either. Armstrong never held it against him, later saying, "I don't think Buzz had any reason to take my picture, and it never occurred to me that he should. I have always said that Buzz was the far more photogenic of the crew." They spent almost 2.5 hours on the surface, documenting the terrain, gathering samples, before climbing back into Eagle. On the lander's ladder, they left a plaque that remains on the moon to this day. "We came in peace for all mankind."
"Hello, Neil and Buzz. I'm talking to you by telephone from the Oval Room at the White House. And this certainly has to be the most historic telephone call ever made. For one priceless moment in the whole history of man, all the people on this earth are truly one. One in their pride in what you have done, and one in our prayers that you will return safely to Earth."
"Thank you, Mr. President. It's a great honor and privilege for us to be here representing not only the United States, but and of peace of all nations, and with interest and a curiosity and with a vision for the future. Honor for us to be able to participate here today."
On July 21, Eagle lifted off, rendezvoused with Columbia, where Mike Collins was waiting to bring them back to Earth. 4 days later, Apollo 11 splashed down in the Pacific Ocean. They returned to a hero's welcome, hailed as symbols of American ingenuity and courage. Armstrong found the public appearances burdensome. He had no interest in the spotlight and repeatedly turned down offers to run for office. He stopped signing autographs after learning they were being forged, and when his barber sold his hair clippings to a collector for $3,000, he was furious. In 1970, he earned a master's degree in aerospace engineering from the University of Southern California and became a professor of aerospace engineering at the University of Cincinnati. He continued flying aircraft into his 70s, but privately, his personal life had become more turbulent. After years of emotional distance and frustration, Janet left him. His friend Harry Combs recalled to author Hansen, "He was in the deepest depression that I've ever seen. It was awful. He would just sit there and glare at the table, not even move." In 1994, Armstrong married Carol Knight, a widow he met through mutual friends. They settled in Cincinnati, not far from where his two sons and their families lived. In August 2012, Armstrong underwent heart bypass surgery to relieve blocked coronary arteries, but complications followed. A few weeks later, on August 25, 2012, Neil Armstrong died at the age of 82. His cremated remains were scattered in the Atlantic Ocean. Even in death, Armstrong avoided the spotlight, choosing a simple naval burial at sea over a hero's grave at Arlington. What truly set Armstrong apart was his composure under pressure and his exceptional problem-solving skills, which saved his life time and again. If you're inspired to sharpen your own thinking and become a better problem solver, I highly recommend Brilliant. Brilliant has helped me build those skills through their interactive lessons in math, science, programming, data analysis, and AI. These lessons are crafted by a team of researchers from Stanford, MIT, Google, and more. You'll learn to think like an engineer with Brilliant Science courses, with lessons on electric and digital circuits, gear systems, and physical structures. Don't miss math essentials like calculus or visual algebra to master the foundations that fuel the Apollo program. One of my personal favorites is their logic courses, which have really helped improve my analytical thinking. The best part is Brilliant is free for you to try out. Visit brilliant.org/newsthink to try Brilliant for free for 30 days. That's brilliant.org/newsthink. The link is in the description, or scan the QR code on your screen. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription, unlocking the thousands of lessons. Thanks for watching. For Newsthink, I'm Cindy Pom.